Ultrasound, MTV's weekly music series. From teen queen to diva supreme, get intoxicated with a tape.
When people ask what this album was like, I mean, I use the word arcane because I think that seems to sum up the music best. It's kind of like music from the past, but done in a futuristic way. There's natural elements on the album, and there's synthetic elements on the album. It's like taking all the textures of all past music and trying to apply it to a kind of a new song form.
Computers and loops and drum machines is a big part of the different kind of sound, and trying to stay away from typical pumpkin cliche things that we do.
The music is very beautiful and sort of timeless. I don't think it will ever be dated sounding. It's just beautiful music.
Adore marks the Pumpkins' first full-length studio album without the rhythmic drum fills of Jimmy Chamberlain. To fill in, they brought on some guest percussionists like Beck's Joey Waronker and former Soundgarden drummer, now on board with Pearl Jam, Matt Cameron. Still, Chamberlain's absence had a marked impact on the band.
I think initially it really limited us because we suddenly didn't really know how to play. You achieve a language, you know, with somebody, and then when that person is not there, the language between, you know, everyone is not the same. This album really is almost like the beginning. It's very similar to how we were before Jimmy joined the band. It's like we went back to where we originally were 10 years ago. The language of that early part of the band came back like immediately. So that's kind of where the album begins, really. Probably the most defined song in that particular way is a song called Shame on the album. You know, I took out the old little drum machine, you know, we've had for like 8 years, and just programmed one beat and we just started playing. You're gonna walk on hell. That probably is the moment on the album that convinced me that this was the direction that we were supposed to be going in. And it's got that same kind of loose, hypnotic quality that the band had 10 years ago.
There's a simplicity to it that reminds me of the style of the things on Gish, a sort of purity.
It's a really good song. It has a really good spontaneous band feel to it. And it, I guess it kind of harkens back to our early days, so. That's a really cool track, but, you know, I don't know, they're all really good tracks.
In addition to the familiar drum machines, Corgan has also been introducing more synthetic soundscaping into the Smashing Pumpkins repertoire on songs like I, which was featured on David Lynch's Lost Highway soundtrack. Is it And on The End is the Beginning is the End, from the Batman and Robin soundtrack. You can't watch the world devour its game. Still, Corgan's pursuit of incorporating technology into the Pumpkins' music was only grudgingly embraced by Darcy.
Her reaction at that particular time was, you know, what is this concept of just like, okay, let's just hook up the synthesizers. Basically what she was trying to say is, what's the heart and soul in what you're trying to get at? Are you doing this because it's just something different, or is it because it's something you really want to do?
I just prefer to do the things as much as possible in an organic way. I know it's much easier if you want to throw some strings down to just do it on the computer, but I just prefer the real thing. Call me old-fashioned.
I think now that she's heard where my interest in it lies, everything from I to Batman to the stuff that ends up on this album, I think she's seen me kind of find what my interest in it really is. You know, we haven't lost our identity in trying to add new textures and sounds to the band.
Corgan was also interested in adding new surroundings for the recording of Adore. The band left the blistering winter of Chicago for the warm sun of Los Angeles and a less public rock and roll existence.
I just found that the life I was living in my hometown of Chicago wasn't really, is bigger than the person that I am. If you come out here, you know, the land of rape and honey, it's like you're third on the list behind movie stars and TV stars, you know. I mean, you know, like, the fifth guy on Frasier is more important out here than any of us, so it's great. You know, we go out and nobody really even cares.
I like the weather, and I rental car, and I would have chai tea and order organic carrot juice, and I did wear some white clothing at one point. And, that was pretty far gone.
I knew that it would either fix things and make it better and we would sort of rise to the occasion, or else it would just fall apart completely. In the end, I think it was a little bit of both.
So, what lies beyond melancholy? Still more music. And hordes of live performances that fans are sure to adore. In terms of the future, the band seems comfortable with their tried and true philosophy. Accept the past and embrace the unknown.
It is pretty amazing, you know, for any band to be together for more than, you know, 5 or 6 years, let alone 10. You know, as long as everything moves forward, it always seems pretty good.
Did I ever imagine that I'd be sitting here talking with you right now about these things in the situation that I'm in now? Yes, I just didn't. We kind of took a very roundabout way of getting here. But I think it was the best route. And I don't think you could change it, because the band wouldn't be what it is if you did.
We love our band, and we're very proud of the music that we make, and we'll fight for it. You know, if you don't like it, you know, we'll be the first ones to tell you to fuck off. But we're lucky people. I mean, we live under, like, lucky stars. All our dreams have come true, and more so, we've got to meet many of our heroes and play in front of millions and millions of people. So millions and millions of records have been part of our culture and our generation. I mean, I won't bemoan that at all.